the title of our sermon this morning, To the Glory of God, To the Glory of God. And this sermon is part two in this text, John chapter 17, verses 1 through 5. And we're coming to part two this morning and looking at these verses and studying together from John chapter 17, the purposes of God the Son to glorify God the Father and all the implications that means for you and I if we are in Christ Jesus. As we come to these verses this morning, you've got in your bulletin a place where you can take notes. I want you to have a pen out and think through this text with me. These things are foundational truths to Christianity, foundational truths to our understanding of what God has done for us in Christ, and we need to understand these things. These things, these truths here are astounding truths. They should impact the way that you think. They should impact the way that you feel. They should impact the way that you live. And we need to apply this text. There's so many people today who profess the name of Jesus Christ that walk around in defeat, walk around clawed about in failure in their Christian life, not understanding these truths. And from this text, there is enough nourishment and sustenance in these verses to sustain you in your Christian life if you'll understand them and apply them. We need to know what this text is saying. We need to see what the Lord is praying for here. We need to understand these things and apply them to our own hearts and minds. Now, in this text, again, what we're seeing is the sweeping scope of God's plans and purposes in the Lord Jesus Christ to redeem a people to himself, and how all of that fits and works together to the glory of God. We saw last week in verse 1, the Lord Jesus Christ and his preeminent passion for the glory of God. He says in verse 1, Jesus spoke these words. He lifted up his eyes to heaven and he said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. As we continue working through the text this morning in verse 2, we're going to see how all of this fits together in a plan for his glory. Point 2 on your notes. A plan for his glory. And we get that from verse 2. If you look at verse 2 with me, where he says, as you, this is the Lord Jesus Christ praying, right? As you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. Put those two things together. Jesus prayed. He spoke these words. He lifted up his eyes to heaven and he said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that your Son may also glorify you, just as you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. Now think about with me again the setting, right? We're in Jerusalem. The Lord Jesus Christ and his disciples are walking on the eve of his death, on the eve of his crucifixion. They've left the upper room and they're walking toward out the eastern gate of the city of Jerusalem across the brook Kidron on their way up the Mount of Olives to the Garden of Gethsemane. It's mere moments before the Lord Jesus Christ will pray in the garden, sweating as it were, great drops of blood, moments before he will be betrayed into the hands of lawless men and taken. Just moments before his mock trial. Moments before his crucifixion. The shadow of the cross lies over his path as he walks. He has followed up his instruction to his disciples in the upper room discourse of John 13 with one of the greatest sermons ever preached in John 14, 15, and 16. And now on the conclusion of that sermon, that instruction to his disciples, his farewell, his parting words to them, the Lord now prays for them. Prays for himself, prays for his disciples, and prays for all of those, the church through the ages. He prays for you and I in this chapter. Now there's a singular petition the Lord asks for in the first five verses here of John chapter 17. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son. That petition in verse 1 is given its singular purpose, right? Its compelling motivation. Its primary focus also in verse 1. That petition is so that your Son also may glorify you. The ultimate aim of God the Son is to glorify God the Father. Now that glory, the Lord's glory, is displayed through his atoning work. That's the hour that the Lord Jesus Christ is referring to. Father, the hour has now come. Glorify your Son. That glory of the Son displayed through his atoning work on the cross, dying for sinners. That's the purpose for which he was sent. That's the purpose for which he came into this world. Having loved his own who are in the world, he loves them, telos, to the end, to the uttermost. He suffers, he bleeds, and he dies, bearing the wrath of God reserved for you. The wrath of God reserved for me. He bears our guilt. He bears our shame. In doing so, he crushes the power of sin, crushes the power of death, right? Crushes the head of the serpent, and raised victorious, exalted to the right hand of the Father, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. God the Father puts all things under his feet and gives him to be head over all things to the church, that at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee should bow and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Now, to what end, for what purpose? If you are familiar with that text, it concludes to the glory of God the Father. Every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Philippians chapter 2, verse 11. To the praise of the glory of his grace. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 6. Blood-bought saints are filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Christ Jesus to the glory and praise of God. Philippians chapter 1, verse 11. You were bought with a price. By the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? To what end? To glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20. The God of all grace called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10. J. Gresham Machen said this: the ultimate end of all things that come to pass, including the ultimate end of the great drama of redemption, is found in the glory of the eternal God. Now, the Son magnified and exalted the Father to the extent that, or to the end that, the Father could be magnified and exalted by God the Son. And God the Son redeemed to himself a people. He redeemed to himself a people, his bride, that would forever live to the praise of the glory of God. Perish each thought of human pride. Let God alone be magnified. His glory, let the heavens resound, shouted from earth's remotest bound. This is the grand purpose of redemption. God's ultimate aim in salvation is to glorify himself. It's not about you, per se. It's not about me, per se. It's about the glory of God. What is the chief end of man? What is a man's chief purpose, man's chief aim? It is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. That command to glorify God, that purpose that we were created for, to glorify God, is an invitation to enjoy him. We enjoy him in glorifying him. That's your purpose. That's my purpose. That's why you were knit together in your mother's womb. Why you were given life. Your purpose is to glorify God. Embrace that when you pray. Think about that when you pray, right? Embrace that when you go to work. Your purpose is to glorify God in your work. Glorify him in your work. Embrace that with how you spend your time. Think about that. Reflect, meditate on that as you strive for holiness in your Christian life. Embrace that end, that purpose in raising your kids, in loving your wife, submitting to your husband. Embrace that in your commitment to this church. Embrace that in preaching the gospel preaching Christ to the lost. Consider what you're doing in light of your purpose, your grand end, your purpose. The reason for which you were created was to glorify God. Consider how you're living your life, whether you eat or whether you drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Now that astounding truth enveloped by verse 1 is connected to verse 2 by that small comparative word there at the beginning of verse 2, as. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you, as you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. Verse 1, if you think about it this way, verse 1 flows out of verse 2, so to speak. In that simple little word, as, we understand that this foundational revelation of glory that we see in verse 1, the purpose of all creation, the purpose of our redemption, is the fruit of verse 2, or is the fruit of that which was planned and given, as we'll see, from before the worlds began. Now, stated another way, the petition for glory in verse 1 is in keeping with the gifts given and the plans that were made as reflected in verse 2. Now, hang in there with me as we walk through this. This is foundational stuff, important for us to understand, okay? Think with me. The glorification or the glory of God the Father is the radiant diamond that sits atop the crowning achievement of the glorified Christ in perfectly accomplishing all the work that the Father had given him to do. Namely, that he should give eternal life to those that the Father had given him. Did you get that? The glory of God the Father is the radiant diamond that sits atop the crowning achievement of the glorified Christ in perfectly accomplishing all the work that the Father had given him to do, namely that he should give eternal life to those the Father had given him. So, when the Lord Jesus Christ then petitions God the Father in verse 1 to glorify him, it's not a self-serving request, right? But he does this on the basis of a plan. He does this on the basis of a plan that was formed in eternity past that would inevitably, inexorably result in his glory and ultimately in the glory of God the Father through the saving of a redeemed people. There were, as S. Lewis Johnson says, divine dealings between the Father and the Son in eternity past concerning the salvation of a people that God the Father gives to God the Son. Turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 1. I want us to understand this point and its implications, how this applies. So we need to build our case here and understand why this is so important to the Christian life. 2 Timothy chapter 1. And look with me at verse 8. Again, divine dealings between the Father and the Son in eternity past. Those divine dealings pertaining to the salvation or the redemption of a people that God the Father, in love toward God the Son, a people that God the Father gives to God the Son. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 8. Therefore, Paul says, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God. Now, Timothy, or Paul here, invites us to share with him in sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God. On what basis? Verse 9. Who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, not according to anything that we've done, not according to anything lovely or lovable within ourselves, but according to his own purpose, verse 9, and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. Now think about what that is saying. But now, verse 10, has been revealed by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Flip the page and look at Titus chapter 1. Titus chapter 1. He has saved us. He has called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, not according to anything about us, but according to his own purpose. Now think about what that means for you, for me, in our response to the gospel, in our Christian life. Look at Titus chapter 1 and look at verse 1. Paul says here, a bondservant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect and the acknowledgement of the truth which accords with godliness, in hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began. Now, if you think about this with me, what we're talking about here again are the divine dealings, so to speak, between God the Father and God the Son in eternity past with respect to a people that God would redeem to himself for the glory of the Son, okay? Paul says here in verse 2, Titus chapter 1, verse 2, in hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised. Now, this was before time began, before creation. Who was God making this promise to? God the Son. God the Son. There were no people here created. Angels hadn't been created. This is an eternity past, before time began. God made a promise. He made a promise to God the Son. Flip the page and look at Hebrews chapter 10. A few pages to the right. Hebrews chapter 10. As you're sitting there, you may be considering yourself where we're going with this, and it's making you uncomfortable. You need to listen to what the Word of God says. You have to deal with the text of Scripture. Our understanding of God, our understanding of his redemptive purposes and plans in Christ, our understanding of our own Christian lives must be fueled by the Word of God, not by your traditions, not by my traditions, not by what we've been brought up on, but by what the Word of God clearly says. Okay? Hebrews chapter 10, look beginning with me at verse 5. Verse 5, therefore, when he came into the world, he, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, when he came into the world, Jesus said, now listen, it's here in Hebrews 10, it's like our author got to sit in on this conversation between the Father and the Son as the Son was on the precipice, so to speak, of his incarnation. Here's what the Son says to God the Father. Sacrifice, verse 5, sacrifice an offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me. That's the incarnation, right? He's going to come with a body. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, you had no pleasure. Then I said, verse 7, behold, I have come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me to do your will, O God. Previously saying, sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings and offerings for sin you did not desire, nor had pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law. And then he said, behold, I have come to do your will, O God. He takes away the first, that he may establish the second. And by that will, verse 10, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Now, if you think about that text with me for a moment, okay? I want you to understand what's being said here. The will of God was that the Lord Jesus Christ should be incarnate, that he should have a body. Behold, a body you have prepared for me, okay? That body, it was the will of God that that body, Jesus Christ in the flesh, would be offered up in death as a sacrifice for sin. That was God's will. He's prepared a body for the Lord Jesus Christ, and God's will in that, in the incarnation, was that Jesus Christ would be offered up in death as a sacrifice for sin. For what purpose? To what end? Verse 10. That his own people might be set apart and saved. By that will, by the will of God, we have, you and I, if you're in Christ, we've been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Now he says here, in the volume of the book, it is written of Christ, I have come to do your will, O God. What the Lord Jesus Christ is saying there is he's accepting the responsibility for coming in the flesh to save sinners. The Lord Jesus Christ delights to do the will of the God the Father, right? He delighted, freely accepted the responsibility to, Philippians chapter 2, make himself of no reputation. He freely came in the form of a bondservant, in the appearance of a man. He freely laid down his life. He says, I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it again. Okay? The Lord Jesus Christ accepting that responsibility given him by God the Father to be incarnate, to be a sacrifice for sin. That will, that plan communicated between the Father and the Son in eternity past, here seen expressed by God the Son on the cusp of the incarnation. It's what John Owen and others have historically referred to as the Pactum Salutis, or the covenant of redemption. These are the divine dealings that took place between the Father and the Son in eternity past concerning the salvation of a people that God would redeem to himself for the glory of the Son. All of these express elements of that plan. It's a plan that eventuates, right? That ends, terminates in the glory of God, the glory of the Son. Now, when was it? We think about this plan and these passages that we've looked at. When was this plan drafted, so to speak? The Bible says before time began, before the ages, before the ages. I was thinking about it this last week. Scientists are coming to the conclusion, many of them, coming to the conclusion that because as science progresses and as they learn more about our universe, they're coming to the conclusion that based on the orderliness of our universe, right, based on its finiteness, right, its working order, based upon its precision, based upon its quote-unquote perfections, based upon how everything fits together and how beautifully everything harmonizes and how well it's held together, scientists are now coming to the conclusion that what science is revealing is that there is an intelligent designer. They won't come to the conclusion that it's God who has designed it, mind you, but they're coming to the conclusion that it's been created by an intelligent designer. All kinds of rationales given for that, right? It's an alien. We are in a grand simulation that there's a higher power that is simulating things by watching us through a microscope, so to speak, you know. Absurdities, right? Absurdities. But they're beginning to be, in that kind of thinking, left with no other option but that based upon how planned our universe is, there must be an intelligent designer. Listen, scientists don't know the half of it. They don't know a fraction of it. When you stop to consider the glories of the plans of God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit in redeeming a people, his redemptive purposes and his redemptive plans are glorious. Glorious. Back in John chapter 17, now think about our setting for a moment as our Lord prays in John chapter 17, beginning in verse 1. In John chapter 17, the Lord is at the very doorstep, right? Standing at the very threshold of the apex of the summit of the culmination of all of redemptive history, the summit of all the redemptive plans and purposes of God, the very apex of all of history. All of history looks forward to the cross. History future looks back at the cross being the focal point of all of history. The Lord is standing at the precipice of that summit. From eternity past, he is the lamb slain. And now in John chapter 17, he's praying in time. The hour, this hour has finally come. The hour having now come for the present fulfillment of that which began in the eternal counsels of the Godhead before time began. It's this hour. All of history has been pressing and pointing forward to this very hour. All the plans from eternity past now coming to fulfillment. And so what the Lord is praying for here in these opening verses, if you think about it, and as he often prays through this prayer in John chapter 17, as we'll see, is the fulfillment or the accomplishment of all the plans and purposes formed within the counsel of the Godhead from before the worlds began. God, glorify your Son. And that fulfillment, that accomplishment, terminates in the glory of God the Son and ultimately in the glory of God the Father. So as the Lord prays here in John chapter 17, verse 2 now, we catch a glimpse of that plan, a plan that was formed within the counsels of the Godhead before time began, now is revealed in part in verse 2. And the Lord prays, glorify your Son so that I can glorify you, Father, just as, verse 2, you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. Now, that plan is seen in three gifts that are given here in verse 2. One, the Father gives the Son authority over all flesh or over all people. The second gift is this, the Son gives eternal life. And he gives eternal life to a particular people the Father gives him. The third gift is that the Father gives the Son a particular people. Now think about what the text says. We have to deal with the text. Verse 2, as you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. Now, the first gift, let's look at that together. The first gift is this, you have given him authority over all flesh. God the Father gives God the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, authority over all flesh. All flesh just means all humanity, all people. Right? God the Father has authority over all people, has authority over all creation. He gives this authority to God the Son. That's amazing when you stop to consider that. That the Lord Jesus Christ has authority over all flesh, and he is about to be arrested and subjected to the abuse of human authority at the hands of the Jewish priests and Roman soldiers here. God himself is sovereign over all the human race. God literally gives the Lord Jesus Christ this authority. And God the Father grants then to God the Son authority or sovereignty over all people. Right? We sing at this time of year, joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. That's right. He's given authority. He's given kingly, sovereign authority over all flesh. He is King of kings, and he is Lord of lords. And that's not only to Christians. If you're here today and you're an unbeliever, listen to me. He is your king, and he is your Lord. He is King of kings and Lord of lords, not only to Christians. He has the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. He has all authority. Now, what does that authority entail? He has the authority to save. We see that in verse 2. He has the authority to judge. That's been given to him. He has the authority to give life. John chapter 3, verse 35 says that the Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. John chapter 5, verse 26, for as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself and has given him authority to execute judgment also because he is the Son of Man. The Bible says that he taught as one having authority, not as the scribes and Pharisees. That with authority, it said that he commanded unclean spirits and that they obeyed him. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18, the Lord says, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples. Colossians chapter 1, verse 17. He is before all things, and in him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have the preeminence. He has all authority given to him. You think about that as it pertains to you and I. The Lord Jesus Christ, as we see in verse 2, has the authority to give life. As we saw in John chapter 5, he also has the authority to judge. You will know God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. You'll know the Lord Jesus Christ here specifically as judge or as federal head, as representative. You'll know God the Father as judge or as father. He's been given authority to either give life or to judge, to save or to condemn. The second gift in verse 2, the Son gives eternal life. Now, that eternal life now is given to a particular people that the Father gives him. Look at verse 2. As you have given him authority over all flesh, so that, or for the purpose, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. Again, think with me as we think through these verses. John chapter 10, verse 27 says this. The Lord says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand." Same concept communicated in Luke chapter 10, in verse 22, where Jesus says, "All things have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows who the Son is except the Father, and who the Father is except the Son, and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him." Where's the will? It's in the Son. See that? John chapter 10, "My sheep hear my voice. I know them, they follow me, I give them eternal life." Luke chapter 10, "The one whom the Son wills to reveal him is the one who knows the Father and the Son." And we'll talk about what that eternal life entails when we get to verse 3. For now, in terms of these gifts, think about it with me. The scope of Christ's authority reaches to all people. The scope of Christ's authority reaches to all people. We understand why. We see that clearly in the Bible. However, the purpose of that gift of authority from God the Father to God the Son is to save a particular group of them. Make the connections. Christ's authority reaches to all people, but in verse 2, the purpose for that grant is that he should give eternal life to as many as the Father has given him. As many as, in verse 2, if you see that, as many as does not equal all. Okay? The fact that the Father gives them, in verse 2, listen, the fact that the Father gives them eliminates the notion that this salvation that's being talked about here is merely potential. As many as does not equal all. What we're talking about here is a specific grant of a people from God the Father to God the Son. As many as does not equal all. The fact that the Father gives them, that people, the fact that the Father gives that people to Jesus Christ, God the Son, so that Jesus Christ can now give them eternal life, eliminates any notion, any idea that salvation is just a potential thing that hangs out there, so that at any time you decide to saunter up to God, "Now it's time, God, that you can have me. I've lived my life in sin." It eliminates that notion altogether. I want you to think with me and how this works out for you and I in the Christian life, how this works out. If you're here today and you're not in Christ, you need to take heed to what John chapter 17, verses 1 and 2 are teaching here. That reality immediately and inseparably links the action of the Son in giving them eternal life with the purpose and intent of God the Father. God the Father grants the Son authority. Why? So that God the Son, with that authority, can grant eternal life to those people that God the Father has given him. That's what John chapter 17, verse 2 is speaking of. What is the purpose and intent of the Father? The purpose and intent of the Father is to save a defined group, a particular people, from among the all. How is that group defined here? It is defined as those whom the Father has given to the Son. In fact, the Bible teaches that he writes their names in a book. He writes their names in a book. It's called the Book of Life. Revelation chapter 13, Revelation chapter 17 says that those names were written in that book before the worlds began. The third gift now. We're going to put all this together in a moment. Hang in there with me. The third gift mentioned in verse 2 is that gift of a people from the Father to the Son. The third gift, a gift of a people from the Father to the Son. Let me ask you a question. Does the authority given to the Son empower the Son to give eternal life to everyone? No. Now, listen to me now. Hang in there with me. You have to deal. We have to deal with these texts. What happens in so many churches today, in so many individual Christian lives, in so many pulpits, is that rather than dealing honestly before God with what God is saying, we will take texts like this and we will shove them off the table, put them over in a corner, in a dark corner that we won't go into and we won't look at, because we want to protect our traditions, protect what we think the character of God is, protect what we have been programmed to believe, and we don't deal with the Word of God. We don't deal with the text. All of these things have to fit together. When you come to a text that says, whosoever will come, you need to deal with that text and deal with it honestly. When you come to John chapter 17, verse 1 and 2, you have to deal with that text and deal with it honestly before God, okay? Does the authority given to the Son empower him to give eternal life to everyone? No. No, it does not here. It's clearly what the scripture is saying. Does the authority given to the Son empower him to give eternal life to just anyone indiscriminately? No. No, it doesn't. The Son has authority to give eternal life to as many as God has given him. The authority of God the Father gives God the Son, empowers God the Son to give eternal life to a specific, definite, and particular group. That group of people that God the Father has given to God the Son. When was that grant made? When was that decision made? Before the foundation of the world. Now that third gift, this understanding brings us to point three on your notes. Point three on your notes, a people for his glory. A people for his glory. Verse 2, again, John chapter 17, verse 2. As you have given him authority over all flesh, so that, or for the purpose that, he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. Now this point, people for his glory, a definite, particular, specific people, is emphasized by the grammar in the verse. And if you're studying your Bibles, I invite you, as you study, to become more and more acquainted with grammar. There's a word in verse 2 that means all. It's the word pon in Greek. It's a singular neuter. It's a collective all. You have given him authority over all flesh. That's that same root word. So that for the purpose that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. The individuals are represented by another Greek word, autois. It's a third person plural. He's talking about the group collectively and the individuals that make up that group. All of those are given to God the Son, that the Son should offer them, give them, grant them eternal life. Okay? Think about that with me. There are those that will say, well, God elected this nebulous group, right? There's this nebulous group, and then what people do is they repent and believe to become a part of that group. No, God here gives the group and all of the individuals that make up that group. That's what the grammar is saying here. You have to deal with the text. It literally means here in verse 2, so that to all you have given to him, that's the group, he should give to them, third person plural, life eternal. There's something else interesting here from the grammar. And it's seen in verse 2 in a repeated verb, have given him. In verse 2, you have given him authority. And then at the end of verse 2, as many as you have given him, right? The first have given him, for you Greek guys, is an aorist. And what an aorist does essentially is sort of take a snapshot of an ongoing verb. You know, it gives the sense that it began at a certain point. It's punctiliar in that sense. But that you're taking a snapshot of the action of a verb, right? So when the Lord, God the Father has given authority to God the Son, we just see a snapshot of that action of the verb, God the Father giving authority to God the Son. Have given him, at the end of verse 2, to as many as you have given him a people, that verb, have given him, is perfect. It's a completed action. It's done. Has present implications, but that verb is complete. It's done. Turn with me to John chapter 6, and let me illustrate this for us. John chapter 6, a few pages back. Keep thinking with me. This is going to all come to an application for you and I. John chapter 6, and look beginning at verse 35. John chapter 6, verse 35. Jesus said to them, verse 35, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. Listen, verse 37. All, every one of them, all of them that the Father gives me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. Do you see how all this fits together within the eternal purposes and plans of God, right? Verse 39, this is the will of the Father who sent me, that of all he has given me, of all of them, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Flip the page and look at John chapter 10. You know, if you think about that, all that the Father gives me will come to me. There are those that would say, well, you know, in John chapter 6 here, he's speaking specifically of the disciples. Well, before you flip to John chapter 10, drop down to verse 65. Listen to verse 65. Verse 65, the Lord said, therefore I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted to him by my Father. Think about how it all fits in, okay? John chapter 17, we're going to get to John 10 in just a moment. John chapter 17, God the Father gives all authority to God the Son so that God the Son then can give eternal life to as many as the Father has given him. Think about with John chapter 6, all those that come to him, no one, not one of them will be cast out. All of those that come to him will be saved. John chapter 6, verse 65, no one can come to him unless it has been granted, gifted by the Father, right? Fit it all together. Look at John chapter 10, John chapter 10, and look beginning at verse 11, a text that we've gone through together. Here the Lord says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for anyone. The good shepherd gives his life for whoever, you know, just thinks one day I want to be saved, right? No, the good shepherd gives his life for the sheep, gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Right? Other sheep, verse 16, I have which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring. Not of this fold, there's a fold that are the Jews. And that's specifically what John chapter 10 is saying. There's a fold of sheep which are the Jews. Jesus Christ is saying, I have an other sheep. I have other sheep which are not of this fold. Those are the Gentiles, right? The Gentiles. Those I must also bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Perfect unity, perfect economy of purpose, perfect economy of work, of result within the Godhead with respect to redemption. Drop down to verse 25. Verse 25. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. As I said to you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall, this group of people known as the sheep, of the fold of the Jews, of the fold of the Gentiles, under one God, one people of God, right? One people of God given to the Son. He says, verse 28, I'm going to give those people eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. That's important to remember. When did this gift of a people, when did this gift of a people take place? It's a people given to the Son, that the Son may give to them eternal life. When did that grant take place? Listen to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to a decision you made walking down an aisle when you were 12 years old. No, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. Listen to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. Paul says, we are bound to give thanks to God always for you, brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God from the beginning chose you for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth, to which he called you by our gospel for the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, what's our response to that beautiful truth? Therefore, brethren, stand fast. Hold the traditions which you were taught, whether by word or our epistle. Let me give you a summary of this, right? From points one, or verses 1 and 2. Let me give you a summary of this, and then we'll put it together. God the Father, in eternity past, God the Father, before the ages began, desired in his infinite and matchless love to glorify his Son. In the eternal counsels of his will, God the Father chose to give the Son a redeemed people, a purchased and precious bride, that through the infinite ages, that bride, that people, would worship and praise and glorify God the Son. That was God the Father's gift of love to God the Son. John MacArthur says it was a redeemed humanity. As the direct recipients of his unmerited favor, it was a redeemed humanity that would stand forever as an eternal testament to the infinite greatness of his mercy and his grace. God the Father chose them. He wrote their names down in the book of life. And the plan was in place then between Father and Son from eternity past to redeem them. And in glorifying the Son, God the Father is glorified. Listen to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And he raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Listen to this. I love this from John Owen. Brother gave this to me. A design in Christ shines out from his bosom that was lodged there from eternity, to recover things to such an estate as shall be exceedingly to the advantage of his glory, infinitely above what at first appeared, and for the putting of sinners into inconceivably a better condition than they were in before the entrance of sin. Think about that statement for a moment. This plan, right, shines out from his bosom. It was lodged there from eternity past to recover things to such an estate as shall be exceedingly to the advantage of his glory, infinitely above what at first appeared, and for the putting of sinners into inconceivably a better condition than they were in before the entrance of sin. He appears now glorious. He is known to be a God pardoning iniquity. He's known to be a God pardoning sin, and he advances the riches of his grace, which was his design. And he has infinitely vindicated his justice also in the face of men, angels, and devils in setting forth his son for a propitiation, a wrath-satisfying sacrifice. It's also to our advantage, Owen says. We're more fully established in his favor and are carried on toward a more exceeding weight of glory than formerly was revealed. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom, both of the wisdom and the knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. God, in his plan, pardons sin and yet upholds his law. He is the justifier and yet he remains just. He's rejected, spurned, forgotten, scorned, mocked by sinful man, and yet he is glorified and honored and praised and worshiped forever. Man dead in trespasses. So God does for man what man cannot do for himself. If you continue to live for yourself in light of this, if you continue to live for your own self-indulgence, if you continue to live for your own glory, then your eternal torment, your eternal punishment, will rise as smoke to the praise of his perfect justice. But considering this, considering the purposes and plans of God, considering the glory of God, the glory of the Son, if you turn to Christ, if you repent of your sin, then your redemption, your worship, your service to him, your praise will rise forever as a sweet-smelling aroma to the praise of his mercy and grace. Angels can't do that, can they? Angels can't worship him that way. They were never redeemed. But you and I were created to worship him that way. Not just worship him with our lips, but worship him with our lives, worship him with our hearts, worship him with our actions. These are glorious truths. And these are glorious truths, but it's amazing to me the gymnastics that people will do to try to avoid what is clearly being taught here in the Word of God. The natural man rebels against these truths. One, they will avoid them, twist them, discount these texts, right? They'll twist these texts. They'll read into the text, eisegete into the text, to make them say what they want them to say, or what they need to say to support their traditions, to support their blind understanding, right? They'll avoid the text, twist the text, discount the text, discredit the text in favor of all the texts that fit their preconceived ideas, fit their agenda. You can't do that. You must deal with the text. Their God, the Arminian God, their God merely foresees down a corridor of time. And yet their God still creates those whom he knows will go to hell. Doesn't solve their problem. What's the sense of electing those who he merely foresees will believe in him? Makes no sense. It's an empty attempt to preserve their primary, their inviolable doctrine, which is the autonomous free will of man. You have to deal with the text of Scripture. What shall we say then because of these truths? Is there unrighteousness with God? Yeah, Paul says, Romans 9, certainly not. Certainly not. Listen to Paul. He says to Moses, listen, Moses, I'll have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. So then, it is not of him who wills, nor is it of him who runs, but it, salvation, is all of God, verse 16, who shows mercy. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I've raised you up, that I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth. Therefore he has mercy on whom he wills, and whom he wills he hardens. You will say to me then, chapter 9, verse 19 of Romans, why does he still find fault then? For who has resisted his will? But indeed, O man, who are you to reply against God? Will the thing formed say to him who formed it, why have you made me like this? Does not the potter have power over the clay from the same lump to make one vessel for honor and another for dishonor? What if God, wanting to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much long suffering the vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, and that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had prepared beforehand for glory, even us whom he called, not only of the Jews only, but also of the Gentiles. As he says also in Hosea, I will call them my people who were not my people, and her beloved who was not beloved. And it shall come to pass in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people, that they shall be called sons of the living God. Thinking about our text, John chapter 17, here verses 1 and 2 specifically, what are we to think of these things? What are we to think of these things? Remember now, in John chapter 17, the Lord is praying in the hearing of his disciples. And the Spirit of God records these words in John chapter 17 for us. And so while some of these things are shadowy, some of these things are difficult to understand, difficult to reconcile, we see in a mirror dimly, these divine purposes are important for us to understand. They were meant for us to understand, meant to be communicated to us. One reason for that is because they provoke us to worship. They provoke us to worship the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. Secondly, they should provoke us to pray, as the Lord here prays. Pray in worship of God. It should humble us regarding salvation, right? I remember when I first came to grips with what the Bible's teaching, Jonathan Edwards called these truths a most hated, detestable doctrine. He believed them because the Bible taught them. I remember thinking to myself, when the light bulb went off and I came to the conclusion, this is what the Bible clearly teaches, and I see it everywhere in Scripture. One of the very first thoughts that crossed my mind was, how do I know that God has saved me, right? It's not of me anymore. It's not my works. It's not what I do. I can't earn it. I can't work my way there. I can't do anything that's going to earn favor with God. Salvation comes from the Lord. And how do I know that God has saved me? It's humbling. It's a humbling position to be in. But the Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, through the Word of God, gives us what we are to do. We are to repent and believe in the gospel. You are to seek the Lord. The Bible says that to be saved, we must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Salvation is of the Lord, so seek the Lord. Don't sit there in your pride and think that you will just add Christ to your life, right? Decorating your life with Christ. No. Seek the Lord diligently. Call upon him while he is near. But it's also vitally important for us to understand our place and purposes in those plans. This impacts the way that we think. It should dramatically impact the way that we live. It should dramatically impact the way that we pray. Most professing Christians today are, you notice I use the word intentionally, professing Christians are entirely self-centered. God is a divine Santa Claus. Listen to the response of the psalmist. Psalm chapter 30, verse 8. David says, I cried out to you, O Lord, and to the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my blood when I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it declare your truth? Hear, O Lord, and have mercy on me. Lord, be my helper. You see David's plea with the Lord there? Listen to David in Psalm 51. He's praying to God to grant him a clean heart. Create in me a clean heart, O God. And then David says this, then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you. Do you see how the response of the genuine Christian lines up with the purposes of God to glorify him, to glorify the Son, right? The psalmist is saved, then he will praise him. The psalmist is saved, then he declares his truth. God in Psalm 51 creates in him a clean heart, then he teaches transgressors his ways. Sinners will be converted to you. Deliver me, David says there, from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise. The psalmist living in accord with the purposes for which God created him, right? Show forth his praise. Would you say this with me, right? Think of this with me. I want to live my life, right? All, every bit that is left of it. I want to live my life for the glory of God, for the ultimate purpose for which I was created, right? In serving that ultimate purpose for which I was created, I want to glorify God. I want to embrace, I want to revel in, rejoice in, live in, swim in, breathe in my heritage in Christ. That my name was written in that book from before the foundation of the world, and Jesus Christ came to this earth, a man, to save me from my sin, that I might praise and worship and glorify God for all eternity. A trophy of his grace, an example of his mercy, his infinite mercy. I want to embrace my calling, embrace what he saved me for. I want to live for the purposes for which Christ died, to glorify God the Son and glorify God the Father. How do we do that? How do we do that? Well, we consider Christ, right? In all the ways that Christ glorified God the Father, he did that in living for God the Father, obeying God the Father. When the Son pursues the glory of the Father, he obeys the Father. Philippians chapter 2, he humbled himself, became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name. Paul poured himself out as a drink offering, praying regarding his hope and earnest expectation that Christ would be magnified in his body, whether by life or by death. So how do you do that? How do you live for the glory of God? To that ultimate purpose? Well, you live to that ultimate purpose by living for the Lord in all of those lesser purposes that all contribute to the ultimate purpose, right? In all of those penultimate purposes. Matthew 28, Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, make disciples. How do you live for God's glory? Make disciples. Make disciples. You teach them to observe all things. Acts chapter 20, Paul says, but none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I receive from the Lord Jesus. It's the same ministry that you and I have received to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. How do you live to the glory of God? You live to the glory of God by testifying of the Lord Jesus Christ, being a witness for him, making disciples, putting off sin, putting on holiness, praying, living this life by faith in the Son of God who died. James 4, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, we ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance, and all such boasting is evil. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. That's how John chapter 17 and that picture of God's glory and his ultimate purposes in redeeming a people to himself, that's how it should impact our thinking, drive us to glorify God. It's the purpose for which you and I were created. Amen? Let's pray. Spend just a few moments, and I want you to pray silently and just do business with God with respect to this text. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I pray, Lord, that we would not be hard-hearted toward these truths, that, Lord, by your Spirit, you would plant them deep within the soil of our hearts and fertilize and water, tend to them there, that we may understand these things, Lord, and live to the glory of God. That we would worship and praise your eternal purposes and plans, Lord, your grace and mercy which has abounded toward us in Christ, that our lives now would be to your everlasting praise and worship. In Jesus' name, amen.